All right, so I think we are good to go. So hi everyone. So we thought we'd make this a bit of a regular thing during the lockdown. So twice weekly, we're gonna jump on here on Facebook Live and do a bit of a Q&A, I guess with an aim to provide people with answers to those questions that usually you'd get from rural professionals on farm at the moment, but obviously during lockdown it is super difficult. So we're here to try and help answer a few of those things that are super topical at the moment. And to mix it up, we are going to involve a few rural professionals from the industry as well. And so this morning I'm joined by James Parsons, who is on the screen as well. So James is from PGG Wrightson's, a technical field rep based out of Waipukurau. It's on the east coast of the North Island. So thank you for coming along today, James.
No problems, Emma. Good to be here.
Thank you. So, James, I guess we want to get you on this morning just to have a bit of a chat about things that are topical in your area at the moment. So, obviously, the east coast of the North Island has been one of the driest regions in the country as of late, but we've finally had a bit of rain in the last 24 hours, which is bloody good. So, so I guess to start off, James, I mean, thinking about your area at the moment, it's been so dry, finally getting a break of rain. What are the kind of things that your farmers are talking to you about at the moment?
Yeah, so that's a question, isn't it? Well, not unusual for us to be dry. Certainly at this time of year, it does happen a bit. The difference being this year is we just had a very, very average sort of November, December lead up into summer, so we didn't carry any extra feed through. So people got through their feed reserves very quickly and have been feeding out basically since the end of January. So supplementary feed has disappeared very quickly, and we've continued to have no rain. I think we've had 40 mils up until this last 2 days for all of January, February and March. So on top of only about 50 mils through November and December, that was, you know, it's been quite trying. So the big thing people have been asking, certainly us, has been about grass selection in terms of what we're going to do moving forward. You know, it's quite hard to convince people to put permanent grass in when it's so dry. You know, you haven't been able to spray out paddocks, so you can't get that nice clean seed bed. You haven't been able to prepare everything as you'd like. So yeah, grass selection, permanent grasses versus annual grasses, you know, oats versus brassicas, all those sorts of questions have been asked as people are looking for options to be able to grow some quick feed and to be able to take animals through winter.
Yeah, no, it's definitely some super challenging times. So, I mean, you mentioned just before around just trying to get things established, and now we've got some rain, and I guess to keep it relevant for everyone else in the country who's watching as well, the big focus is just trying to get a lot of this perennial pasture in the ground before things do get too cool. So, I mean, you've got a pretty good background in fertiliser and whatnot. What would be some of the considerations, I guess, people just need to make sure they're ticking the box with fert, with their establishing their new perennial pastures?
Yeah, the key thing, especially with establishing perennial pastures, is because they can be a little bit slower out of the ground. So you want to give them as much, you know, possibility to establish as quick as you can. So certainly some fertiliser down the spout, some phosphate beside the seed, just to help it germinate as quick as you can. So if we think about phosphate, it's for germination, and nitrogen's for multiplication, I suppose is a simple way of putting it. So make sure phosphate for germination, and then when it jumps out of the ground, putting some early nitrogen on it to get it to multiply, so till her out. And the quicker you do that, the quicker you're going to be able to get an early graze off it. So that's quite important. And then obviously, on the flip side of that, we've got our older pastures, which may be new grasses from last year, for example. They are still going to have some pretty high requirements because they're going to be growing, you know, they're probably the first thing to grow once it rains. They're still growing quicker than everything else. So making sure our annual fertiliser is going on there, so our nitrogen, our phosphate, our sulphur and our potassium, any trace elements that are needed, they're quite important. And if you get your mix right and the timing right, you can certainly add some nitrogen to that to give it a bit of a boost. And ag research have done a lot of work and trials on, you know, early applications of nitrogen coming out of a drought, and basically the earlier the better. So although you'll have good nitrogen reserves in the soil, the plant will certainly respond to any added nitrogen and you'll just grow more yield. So you know, that's independent, that work that's been done over the years, and it's pretty accurate, and I've certainly seen it work very well.
Yeah, no, there's absolutely, I couldn't agree more. And I guess just on that nitrogen thing, a lot of people are, certainly there's just a little bit of concern around nitrate issues this year as well, and something to, I guess, be mindful of. And I was on here last week with Charlotte Westwood, our veterinary nutritionist, and yeah, she's actually had a few people ask her about nitrates as well specifically. So instead of James and I probably rambling on about it, we've deferred it to the experts, and Charlotte's actually going to run a session solely on nitrates in the Rumen Room, which is a group that we run with PGRs and Seeds, and Charlotte kind of is going to jump on there and give us a real good Q&A just around what we should be conscious of and some tips and tricks around that. So we'll park the nitrates and we'll leave that for Charlotte, and I'll put up a link in the in this live chat afterwards on how you can find that with Charlotte tomorrow. So
the nitrate thing is very important, and it certainly gets discussed year on year. And look, regardless of the year and what's happening in the ground and the season, you're going to get nitrates, especially in your winter crops, so oats, annual grasses, brassicas, you're going to get it pretty much regardless. Yeah. So my philosophy is, you know, at the end of the day, you need to grow yield. You need to grow as much as you can. You can deal with the nitrates when they arise through various shapes and forms. So let's worry about growing a crop first, because that's what you want, that's what you're paying for.
Yeah.
Get the yield in the bank and then worry about that, that side of things afterwards, because... Yeah. It can be worked through.
Yeah, exactly. So worry about that yield, and then Charlotte will provide us with some awesome kind of grazing management tips. So if nitrates is in fact going to be an issue for that particular paddock or whatnot, she'll provide some really good practical stuff tomorrow. So that'd be really cool. So James, I guess that probably leads in quite nicely to this annuals versus annual oats conversation. I mean, we're probably quite fortunate on the East Coast here that the soil temperature is still not too bad. You measured today, and what was that down in Waipukurau?
Yeah, so we're still 17.5 degrees at the moment. So still really good soil temps after about 20 mils of rain here in the town and 100 mils of rain out towards the coast and sort of 20 mils west of Waipuk. So soil temps are still very good. But in saying that, we're getting later in the season. So basically the conversation now for most of our clients is around putting short rotation grasses in because our growth season is so dependent on winter feed.
Yeah.
So through March through to basically October, November, that's our growth period. So we've got to concentrate on growing as much feed as we can in that period. So that's obviously where annual grasses like Winter Star fit right into that market, with short rotation grasses. So we're doing a lot of that at the moment. Now, it's not too late to put perennial grasses in by any stretch, but there is, you know, will certainly affect your yield and what you're going to get out of it over the winter. So yeah, people are certainly swinging towards winter grasses or oats.
Yeah, exactly. And you know, just conversations with our team, the kind of recommendation is once it's below 14 degrees, then you do really want to make that switch, just because, and I guess adjust those expectations, because it's all about trying to establish those perennial pastures as quickly as possible if it is getting too cold for them, which in many parts of the country, we're probably there now. It's about making that switch. So, James, well, I wonder
if the practicalities of that are that you're gonna get a paddock to green up now after a bit of rain. So that's going to take, you know, 3 or 4 days to get sprayed. So then you're basically talking, you know, trying to get a drill, you know, the 5th, 8th, 10th of April. So we are moving on in time.
Yeah.
So again, more of an opportunity to get annual grasses in my opinion.
Yeah, no, I couldn't agree more. So just on that annual kind of topic, it might just be good. I've actually just had a question come through just around annual versus annual and oat mixes. So it might actually just be worth having a bit of a chat about that, James. But I mean, if people come to you saying, should I be planting annuals versus oats? I mean, what's the kind of conversation that you're having with them to kind of firm up what's the best option?
Yeah, and look, there's so many ways to skin that cat, Emma, and we're doing a lot of options around that. We're doing a lot of straight annual grasses. We're doing oats and annual grass mixes through various shapes and forms. So it very much depends on each farmer's situation. If they're wanting bulk feed, they're wanting to hold animals in a confined space to get them through winter and control their spring flush, then certainly oats is the best option, too late for brassicas this time of the year. But if they're wanting, you know, something that's going to maybe take them through spring a little bit more in terms of regrowth, then they can obviously annual grass by itself is good. Or we're doing oats and annual grass mixes. So if you can manage to look after your paddock during the winter in terms of not doing too much hugging damage, suitable soil type to do that, then certainly you can add some annual grass to it. And once the oats have grazed off, you can get regrowth through the spring. So that is an option, but again, depends on what you want to do with that paddock in the spring.
If you want to take it
out and back into another crop in September, October, then you'll probably get full benefit of it. But again, every circumstance is different.
Yep, no, couldn't agree more. It's all about that feed demand, the bulk versus your multi-graze. And I guess in instances, we've just had a question come through just around the mixing. I mean, it's kind of just going to depend on what you're after. Typically, I mean, I don't know what you're probably along these lines, James, but if you're wanting the more bulk, then you'd obviously have a heavier weighting to oats. So say 80 of oats and 10 to 15 kilos per hectare of like your annual ryegrass. Or if you're going for the more quality option, probably down to like 60 kilos a hectare of oats and 20 kilos of annual. I guess it provides a little bit more flexibility if that's what you're after. They both kind of have their pros and cons in that space, I guess.
If you get through your oats early enough and you've got the right selection of oats, you can get through in August, and then you've got some winter style annual grass coming through underneath it, which is great to lamb on. For 4 to 6 weeks before you decide to take that paddock out.
Exactly. I've just had a question come through, James, from David. So just looking at 100 kilos of oats with 15 kilos of Italian per hectare, would that need more fibre, baleage, et cetera, to be fed with it? Or is it okay? I mean, we'd always advocate, especially, they're super low in dry matter, of course, these forages. So, I don't know what your thoughts on that are, but...
It's an interesting one. Like you'll put some fibre with it and they'll either really want it or they won't, and the animals will tell you that. My philosophy is always to have it available for them because they want that balanced diet. Although the annual grasses will certainly give you some good quality feed, once the oats start growing a bit longer, they provide plenty of fibre anyway. Just balancing that diet out really, so the animals will tell you.
Yeah, and particularly at the start, especially if we're trying to manage, potential nitrate issues and if both of those crops are quite low in dry matter and that kind of thing. So I'd always advocate that 80-20 rule, at least 80 crop, 20% of some kind of roughage. Hey, James, just to finish off, I'd be really keen to just chat with you about raphno. So it's been a massive year for raphno on the east coast of the North Island this year. And you guys are right in the heart of that, really. So I'm just kind of keen to hear from you in terms of how it's gone during the season. And now that we're at the end of March, what are we looking to do? Or, what are your farmers doing with those crops?
It's a great conversation to have. We've sold, I think, close to just under 1,000 hectares of raphno in St. Hawke's Bay this year. And by and large, it's been a huge success. Certainly the only thing that's been regrowing just about and looking green after a very, very dry summer. So most people have done lambs on their raphno and done very well. They've managed to finish a lot of their lambs over the summer period and get good regrowth from it. A few people done cattle on it too, which have been quite interesting. And they are reassessing those crops at the moment. The difficulty with cattle is you do tend to get a little bit more plant mortality. So you've got to have a bit more handle on your plant numbers going into winter in terms of what you're doing with it. But probably 95% of the farmers are taking their raphno through winter this year. So we've been out doing plant counts just to make sure we've got enough plant numbers there to sustain a decent yield through winter. And sort of our view, you sort of need to be around about that 20 plants per square metre, which if we get down here and look, most of them seem to be about that way. Even a little bit less than that, we're probably oversowing with a little bit of oats or maybe some annual grass just to top it up. Most of them are looking pretty healthy and will make it through winter quite nicely.
Yeah, no, I couldn't agree more. And I think the dry season's definitely worked in favour. Like the plant numbers are actually really good. I'd certainly be comfortable with that 15 to 20 plants per square metre. I would leave it as is. As you say, once you drop below that, there's definitely an option just to top it up. And I guess, if anything, it just helps give you a little bit more bulk to carry through the winter. James, you mentioned before that some guys in your area, just as these pastures wake up after such a dry spell, that some guys are actually sacrificing a bit of potential winter raphno yield by keeping on those crops just at the moment to give their pastures a break. what would kind of be cutoff point for you in terms of, right, let's shut this crop up and end for winter?
Yeah, if you look at last year, which is obviously a completely different season, but very, very growthy autumn, we were generally shutting our raphno crops up around about the 20th of March onwards to about the 1st of April. And shutting them up for winter feed and, you know, potentially growing sort of 8 to 9 tonne of dry matter, which we were measuring. This year, you know, the best advice is to sort of, if you can, stay on your raphno a little bit longer to give your grasses a chance to recover after the drought and grow some yield. Because if you go straight back onto your grasses after rain, you just don't really grow the grass and don't need it to recover and tiller out. So, yeah, the flip side there is you do sacrifice some yield or winter dry matter yield for your brassica crops. But it just depends on where your priorities are. You will still got probably another 2 weeks to 3 weeks of grazing these raphno crops before I'd really want them shut up. And if you're going to be doing that, I'd be certainly advocating getting some nitrogen on to boost a bit of yield. You know, the response rate for nitrogen on brassicas can be anywhere up to 25-1 response. So economics are certainly there, and certainly the agronomy is there in terms of growing extra yield.
Yeah, brilliant. No, couldn't agree more. And I mean, obviously, we're talking from soil temperatures on average are a lot warmer over here. So so likely guys down south and in cooler regions are potentially making that move right now. But yeah, it'd certainly be saying that if you haven't gone out and assessed those crops and thought, right, what are we doing with them? Do go out and do some plant counts just to make sure you can justify carrying it through. There's enough plant numbers to justify a good amount of bulk this autumn. And yeah, just putting those plans in place to look at shutting those paddocks up. So yeah.
And also with that is to make sure once you've shut them up and before you graze them, is certainly get a yield check on them and see how much dry matter you've actually got. Send the sample away and get it tested, because the variation of dry matter does change quite a bit between species and between different times of the year. So get a good accurate idea of what you've got in the paddock, so that you know, and do a feed budget in terms of how many numbers you can actually put on.
Yeah, 100%. No, feed budgeting is super important, and so is that dry matter testing. We might actually come on here a bit later and at a later date and actually just run through how we could yield those crops and do some DIY dry matter testing. So doing those at home with potentially an old microwave or something like that. But couldn't agree more, James, because the difference between assuming a dry matter percentage and an actual one can sometimes be massive, and you're either gonna severely under or overstock your crop. So we don't want either of those situations to occur, because they're probably both as niggly as each other. But definitely it's would pay to get out and do those yields. And sometimes what you'll find with raphno, if you are grazing those crops, say mid-June, what you end up with in late July is actually probably quite different as well. So doing those repeat assessments is important as well. So Yeah, that is brilliant. Well, James, thank you so much for jumping on today and helping us out with a few questions. Hopefully that was useful for those of you that are watching. And as I mentioned, we're keen to jump on here twice a week just to try and cover things that are topical at the moment. And as I mentioned earlier, Charlotte Westwood will be doing a nitrate specific Q&A over in the room and room tomorrow. But for the meantime, we will check out and catch you guys on Thursday. Thanks, James. Awesome. See ya.
See you.